video. So.
Let me tell you now. I took her home to my place, watching every move on her face. She said, look, what's your game, baby? Are you trying to put on a shade?
I liked the song, so I said, oh, I'm going to do a video. I almost did it on Ozzy, but it was Highway to Hell, so I didn't do it there. I wasn't sure when I'd make it. I'm going to do Soren Kierkegaard, and then talk about the chapters of the Bible that he mentions, sure it's on, that he mentions in the book. The book, I've done philosophy posts, you know, over the years. And then I've done a couple posts on the classic writings, the classics of Western literature. And it's, you know, why do I do some of that? I think a lot of the defense of Christianity that we do as teachers, people have done for many years, one of the defenses is how embedded Christianity is in everything. I remember C.S. Lewis. Oh, I found something. I don't know what it is. A little skeleton. I remember C.S. Lewis. I was reading recently. I've read him before. But there were a lot of critics of Christianity. And you've heard me cover this. The 19th century liberal theologians or liberal teachers that came out of the universities of Germany. I've covered a lot of this in the past. But I read a quote from Lewis a couple weeks ago. And C.S. Lewis was a scholar, an intellectual. He wrote the books, The Chronicles of Narnia. And they were children's books. And he has a great story. It would actually fit in with what I'm going to talk about. I didn't think of that until just now. But he wrote one of the books. The famous book from C.S. Lewis is called Mere Christianity. I could cover these as classics, but he also wrote one on grief. And it had to do with, there was a lady in the United States, I had no idea I'm going to talk on Lewis, and her child read the books from C.S. Lewis, because they were children's books. And she goes, I think her name was Joy. There's a movie about this called Shadowlands, which is the life of C.S. Lewis, or this story. And so she goes to visit C.S. Lewis. In the movie Shadowlands, he's played by Anthony Hopkins, who's an excellent actor. And she visits Lewis, and he that she wants to marry him, and he's a bachelor, and he teaches at a university, you know, in England and Britain. And he tells one of his friends, I'm gonna go ahead and marry her. And so she becomes the love of his life. And I believe, I haven't read this in many years, but I think she dies of cancer. And then one of the books she wrote was Grief. And it was about the lost love. Now, Kierkegaard, just so happens, we're going to discuss a little of that, but in Lewis's writings, he defended Christianity because the quote I read recently, a lot of the critics were starting to say, I've read the Gospel of John, and I've read this, and we've studied it, and it's myth. It's myth, it's poetry. Now, you do have poetry in Scripture. It's a whole other story, and you don't take poetry as literal. Okay? It's important to understand that when you study the genres of Scripture. Historical narrative, poetry, so forth. But Lewis wrote, he said, all of these theologians, Bultmann and these guys, they all say it's myth. It's poetry, romance, but it's not a historical narrative. It's not true. These are just stories. And Lewis says, what I want to know is how many of you guys that are saying that, how many of you have read great romance novels? How many of you have been in depth in poetry and all? None of them, because they were just had doubts about Scripture. He said, I've read all of these poetry, because Lewis was a scholar before he became a believer. He said, and then when I read the New Testament, he gave the story where Jesus, they came, the Pharisees said, we caught this woman in adultery, and Moses and the law says we're supposed to stone her. What do you say, Jesus? Jesus writes in the dirt. He stoops down and writes in the dirt. And people say, what did he write? Some say maybe he wrote the sins or the people that they were sleeping with themselves, the names. Either way, but what Lewis was saying is this is not myth. Why? Why would you record, if you're writing a story that's just myth, you want everything to sound good, why would you add something like that, especially when there's no explanation for what he wrote? The only reason you would add things like that is because you're given historical narrative. And if somebody did something like that, and you didn't know what he wrote, or it's not recorded what he wrote, the only reason to include that in the gospel would be you're doing a historical narrative. He did this. So Lewis, he chided the critics. He said, y'all are saying it's all myth and romance. Lewis says, I've read C.S. Lewis. I've read all the myths and romance. And he said, this is not myth. But Kierkegaard, we're going to cover. Okay, Søren Kierkegaard was the 19th century Danish philosopher. Denmark, even when I was reading a little bit on him, I was singing the old song from Hans Christian Andersen, what I watched as a kid, out of Copenhagen, Denmark. Wonderful, wonderful Copenhagen. And I read some quick stuff on him earlier, and it mentioned he was a critic, Kierkegaard, but even of Hans Christian Andersen was mentioned in some that I was writing. So, Kierkegaard was writing at a time where the arguments for God, which you hear me make, from philosophy, from history, from science, and the arguments for the faith as a reasonable faith, you can argue for the existence of God from rationality and from reason and from historical evidence and from scientific proof. I believe all that, and you've heard me do that, teach that over the years. That's called apologetics. But Kierkegaard saw, he was very critical of religion, organized religion. Okay, so you're seeing in him much of what you kind of see in the evangelical movement, which I don't fully agree with, which is a rejection of tradition, rejection of all historic Christianity. But you do see the seeds of this in Kierkegaard. And he criticized the state church of Denmark. And he said, all of the arguments for God, from reason, from science, from history, from ethics, he said, unless you have an actual relationship with the living God through Jesus Christ, highly evangelical there, he said, all of that doesn't really amount to anything. So he's writing, and he wrote poetry, he wrote on culture, philosophy. Some of the books he wrote Thus, he used this, different names, like pseudonames, a pseudonymy. Basically, you're writing under another name. But he also wrote Christian books that were blatantly Christian, and those would have his name. Now, Fear and Trembling is a book about, it's his most famous book, and it's about the story of Abraham you find in Genesis chapter 22. And God tells Abraham, I've taught it before and I might post some of my past teaching. I did a whole commentary on Hebrews and Hebrews 11 I'm going to hit on. I might post that, paste that. But God tells Abraham, God made a promise in Genesis 12, in Genesis 15, in Genesis 17. You trace what we call the Abrahamic covenant or promise. And God picked a man. I just read this in Acts 7 last night, just in my regular reading. And Stephen, the martyr, covers this. Acts 7 is a good historical history of the nation of Israel given by Stephen, one of the first deacons. And you can read that and get a good overview of the history of the Bible right from that one chapter, Acts 7. And God told Abraham, he called Abraham as a pagan. And he said, I want you to leave your country, your familiar surroundings, your family, and I want you to go into a place that I will show you of. And if you do these things, I will make of you a great nation. I'll give you all types of children and generations and families, and your seed and children will bless all the nations of the earth. But you got to obey me, Abraham, by faith. And the Bible says that Abraham went out not knowing where he was going. He didn't know. God said, just go, foot loose. And as he went, in progression of time, it's a very interesting story you read about in Genesis. Paul uses these examples in his theology in Galatians and Romans. Very, very important teaching for the New Testament. But in the life of Abraham, he had struggles, he had problems, he made mistakes. But most of all, Abraham was not having any kids with his wife Sarah. And the promise was, look, if you go, I'm going to give you a land. It was a land promise, which we call the promised land. We read about that being fulfilled in the book of Joshua, when the children of Israel finally take the land. But the promise was you're going to have all these kids, so many as the stars you couldn't count them, as the sand that's by the seashore. But he's not having kids, and Sarah's not getting pregnant, and Abraham does various things. He says, well, maybe this servant kid that I have, I think his name was Eliezer. I've not read all this, I've just talking off the top of my head. But Eliezer, this servant kid, maybe we'll count him as the son. Maybe that's how God's going to do it, you know. But it wasn't that. God said no. Then Sarah had a maid named Hagar, Abraham's wife Sarah. And being she was not getting pregnant, she tells Abraham, which was something that was acceptable in those days, sleep, she would be a surrogate mom. Sleep with my maid Hagar, and that's how we'll have the promise. And he does. And he has a son called Ishmael. And Ishmael, the Muslims trace their roots to Ishmael. And that's one of the sons of Abraham. But in process of time, God continues to say to Abraham and Sarah, Sarah is going to have a child, and she's about 90 years old, and Abraham's about 100. And they think it can't be. There's some stories where they laugh. Sarah says, there's no way I'm going to get pregnant. Finally, she gets pregnant and has Isaac. And God said, see, I told you Sarah would have a son. I told you, Abraham, after all these years of you living by faith, going into a strange land in Acts 7, which I just read, Stephen says, but God did not give him any possession in that land. See, he didn't possess it yet. It would come many years later. But yet he went by faith. It says, Hebrews 11, these all lived by faith, not having received the promises, but having embraced them, that they were far off. They would be fulfilled after their death. And this is a very key teaching in Scripture. It's not that you will see things in your life necessarily, but after you die, God will fulfill everything he said. That's faith in Scripture. So, they have this kid. Finally, Isaac's born. Promised child, all these years. He's the one that's going to have so many children and so many grandchildren. And then God says in Genesis 22, Abraham, I want you to go get Isaac and offer him on a mountain as a sacrifice, Mount Moriah, the same hill that Jesus was crucified on historically, Calvary. And Abraham, it says in Genesis 22, he went and got Isaac. He got the wood, the fire, and they're going. And there's some servants there. We're going to go make an offering. And Isaac asks his dad, he said, Dad, we have the wood, we have the fire, we have everything. Where's the offering? Where's the lamb? Where's the sacrifice? And his father says, Son, God will provide himself a sacrifice. God's going to give us a sacrifice. And then he tells the servant, says they're going, Abraham thinks he's going to offer Isaac in his mind. He tells the servants, wait here. Me and the lad are going to go worship. And we will return. And it says in Hebrews 11 that Abraham was fully persuaded in his mind that God would have raised him from the dead in the same figure that he received him. Meaning Sarah was so old that it would be beyond the time of bearing children, but yet God gave him like life from the dead. And in order for Abraham, who's an example of God, and Isaac, who's a symbol of Jesus, in order for him to fulfill that type, that symbol, he had to have been persuaded that not only he was going to actually kill Isaac, but he had to also have been convinced in his own mind that God would raise him from the dead. Because that's the only way God could actually have fulfilled the actual image. It says Jesus himself, he died in faith, knowing the promise of the Father that he'd be raised. So really, God had to trick Abraham in order for Abraham to be fully persuaded in his mind that this promised son would be raised from the dead, so he could really fulfill the symbol, okay? In the book Fear and Trembling, Kierkegaard says, Abraham struggled. And understand the little background I gave you. Kierkegaard, he's combating the strong reason rationalism that was taking place within the theological circles. And he's trying to say, he had three stages of life. He said the first is like the spectator artistic stage. He said that where people are just spectators, they're enjoying the great poets, the great artists, but they're not seeing all of the stuff they're going through, the struggles, the depression, all of the things that produce the great art or the great works. He says the spectators just see the end result, and they like, oh, we like seeing this wonderful art from these men and Picassos and all, guys that were cutting their ears off and all types of Van Goghs and all, because of the great struggles that produced that great work. And so Kierkegaard said that's stage one, that's just simply the spectator stage. And if I remember right, he also put the ivory tower intellectuals in that stage. He said, y'all are smart, you're reasoning, ethics, all these things. He says, but you have no real passionate engagement with God that transcends all of your mind. And stage two was the ethics stage, because many of the liberal theologians reduced theology and scholarship to the fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of man, and just the basic ethical life. They were denying all the miracles, supernatural. They said it's really just about a moral life, which that plays a role, but what Kierkegaard was saying is, no, that's not real faith either at stage two. But stage three, that's where you get true religion in his mind, which was beyond all that. It was more than ethics and reasoning and rationality, and it was more than that. He almost taught what many scholars will resist, a form of relativism. Relativism, subjectivism, means there's no objective truth. And in the field of theology and philosophy, these are debated, and normally the Christian apologist, the scholar, the theologian will argue for objective truth. And normally it's the Nietzsche's and the others that reject God that fall on the relativistic side, the subjective side, and they say, no, there's no real truth. Okay, I taught that Nietzsche in the other video. But he embraced a form of this. He's considered the father of existentialism. But he said, actually, in our passionate pursuit of God, and the story of Abraham, which he covers in the book Fear and Trembling, he says, the command of God to him was unethical. See, he's saying it was kill your son, which is a violation of one of the Ten Commandments. It was also irrational because people would never understand it. Kierkegaard taught that when you're in that place of depression and he talked about suicidal tendencies. I think he lived in a state of depression because he died at the age of 42, which was young. And some people think the book Fear and Trembling is an autobiographical account of his own experience because he fell in love with a girl named Jean Olsen. I think that was her name. And he felt God had said, break off the engagement because that's your sacrifice, that's your Isaac. And so he purposely did not marry that girl, though she was the love of his life. And he was in like a form of depression. And he wrote about Job. He said Job was in a place where he wanted to die, but he could not find death. And then he talked about the prisoners and the solitary confinement. He says they're in a state where they seek death and can't find it. So he spoke passionately, and you could see depression in what he was saying. And so he says Abraham, actually his faith, it transcends ethics, because it was actually unethical. It transcended reason because it didn't make sense. But yet he had that passion of faith. So that's really what you're seeing in the book Fear and Trembling. And he gives, I think, about four scenarios of like Abraham had doubt. He gives different scenarios, and they're not actually the scriptural view, the actual story which I was quoting. But he gives them to show other sides to it. So Fear and Trembling by Søren Kierkegaard, the 19th century Danish philosopher, is considered one of the classics of literature. As you study the classics, that's in there. Hebrews 11, I read it the other night. I've taught the whole book of Hebrews. But it says, all of these promises that were made, the city, the land, the people, it says they were not fulfilled in the actual promise of Canaan, which is the Old Testament promised land, which is the nation of Israel, Palestine today. It said, but they looked for a city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. For God hath prepared for them a city that has foundations. And those that were the patriarchs, the Old Testament figures, that were receiving these promises, it says, they realized that the promise wasn't actual land, but it was a heavenly city. It was the community. It was this community we have where Jesus right now is at the right hand of the Father, and we are called the city of God. John in the book of Revelation says, I, John, saw the holy city descending down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. So the writer of Hebrews in chapter 11 says they were looking for the city, the church, the people of God. Us who live here now in the communion of God, and those who have moved on, it even says in Hebrews, we have these people in the stands, those who have already died, and they're watching this great cloud of witnesses. Hebrews 11 says, they all obtained a good report through faith. I taught this, how I felt that this chapter was an effort in the account of the New Testament writings to join James and the writings of Paul. I taught that because Paul's writings in Romans, Galatians, justification by faith, the story of Abraham, they're very strong. James led the New Testament on justification by works. But yet in Hebrews 11, the writer, and I think Paul wrote it, but the writer's saying, all of these men, they did these things. Even Rahab the harlot, she received the spies with peace. And since they all received a good report by faith, I think it was Paul the Apostle's effort to say, me and James, who wrote the letter of James, who was the lead pastor in Acts 15, Church of Jerusalem. I think it was Paul's effort to say, me and James are not disagreeing theologically. You're seeing different aspects of what God has shown us. I believe Hebrews 11 is that chapter. I've taught it that way, but I can't do that now. Because today was fear and trembling. So we today understand that even though we have knowledge, we have wisdom, Paul said in Corinthians 13, all of those things are good. But love is that passionate embrace of life. It's really, existentialism is a hard philosophy to teach. I'm not sure if I fully understand it. In a simple format, it would be, I would say, it's the philosophy of existence. You're living in the moment with God. You're actually having a real experience in your life with God. It's reality. It's not just ethics, intellectual understanding, all these things. He says you got to have a passionate pursuit of God to the point where even when you don't understand what he tells you, you do it by faith. That's faith. And so in a way, Kierkegaard, I'm surprised because I have a scholar I listen to and study. His name is R.C. Sproul. And Sproul is very traditional Reformed theologian, but he's a good scholar and I've studied him for years. And normally the Kierkegaards, the guys like Sproul normally would not agree with Kierkegaards. Sproul is very negative on Karl Barth, the Swiss theologian who I mentioned, neo-Orthodox theologian. But yet Sproul spoke very highly of Kierkegaard, and I was surprised in the CDs. I have books in the past I've read by Sproul. I gave those away. But in the recent CDs I listened to, he spoke highly of Kierkegaard. He said he was a great fan of Kierkegaard, and that surprises me because some that disagree with Sproul's theological viewpoints, they appeal to Kierkegaard to say that the Sproul theologians are wrong and we are right. But yet I thought it strange that Sproul liked Kierkegaard. And he explained because when he was studying theology himself, he said a lot of the theology he was studying as a scholar, learning to be one, he said, it was dry, it was dead. And he said when they got to Kierkegaard in his classes that he was a student, he said it revived a passion. You saw an actual passionate reality of what it meant to pursue God. A real thing, not just all what we see in Christianity today. That performance mentality. So Sproul liked it. Okay, it's about 30 minutes. I'm going to teach a little bit more, write a little on these chapters, and then maybe post this today. As I make it, it's a Wednesday afternoon. So maybe it'll go up Thursday or Friday. Okay? I want to bless all you guys. It's still a little hot right now, but read those things. Maybe read the book. I've not read the book. I've read a lot of books, and I've read some of the classics, but I've not read Fear and Trembling, but these are reviews. I've read the book. I have a book on many of the classics of Western literature. I bought it years ago. Every now and then, I like to do some of that, okay? The Lord bless thee and keep thee. I'm not getting it right, but the Lord make his face shine upon thee. The Lord be gracious unto thee, and the Lord give you peace.